just gonna put my rings back on. If you know me, you know I'm always wearing rings, a bunch of rings. My cousin calls me Thanos. And I just took them off because I just filmed a quick little, like, removing makeup video. So I'm gonna put these back on for me to feel comfortable. But, just wanted to check in. It's been a while, but it's pretty late right now. It's almost 1 a.m. This is around the only time I can get any quiet in the house. So, that's part of why I haven't uploaded as often, but a lot of other moving pieces. But I don't want to start off with the negatives. They're all my rings. I like wearing rings. I always get compliments on my rings. There was a cool guy at Starbucks yesterday. And he had some cool rings on. And I said, wow, I like your rings. I don't know if you heard that I was getting a FaceTime call. I really enjoy this cup that I got from Target. I've had it for a couple months. No, maybe like a month and a half. I love it. It keeps your drink nice and cold. I just have water in here. I never did a proper Wonder Woman review. So let's just like talk about it a little bit. First disclaimer, look at this. I'm missing a couple of nails. Actually three. These are just press-ons. They're nothing special. But they make fun noises. Is that tingly? I have the mic set up over here. And I don't know what this sounds like because I lost my little earbuds. I'm all over the place. There's a couple of things I wanted to do. We'll get into Wonder Woman because I want to know what you guys thought. It came out on December 25th, so it's been a while, so, you know, hopefully you've already seen it. I know it's not streaming anymore, but if you're in a place where there are movie theaters, perhaps you've been able to go watch it in theaters, I don't know. I mean, I'm in a place where there are movie theaters, but I mean movie theaters that are open, you know what I mean? I thought that we could do something fun for to start off, actually. I have to take my vitamin. I just picked up a prescription yesterday. It's just a refill. I have a few prescriptions for a few different things. That sounded dark. But this particular one is not very, it's not too crazy. It's just vitamin D because, I have something to share with you all. I'm vitamin D deficient right now. It's pretty crazy. So my doctor has me on vitamin D, like some extra powerful vitamin D. Although I think a lot of us right now are probably vitamin D deficient and you don't really know it. Because, you know, with lockdown and different places in the world and, you know, we're just not outside as often as we probably have been in the past. As much sun. Oh yeah. Nothing like a brand new prescription. Yeah, I have. some thoughts. I wrote them all down on the notes app, like the day I watched her. I'll show you. That's so much. I forgot I wrote that much. Yeah, it says right here. Hope you can read that. Let's see. Let's let that focus. Is it gonna focus? December 26th, 2020. Because I watched it, on the 25th. And then I watched it, like, two more times on the 26th. And then I proceeded to watch it a couple more times, but we won't get into that. What did I write down? I'll just kind of go through what I wrote. So I wrote about the beginning. We had a very strong start with the Amazonian Olympics. Also, this won't have too many spoilers. It won't have anything that really spoils the plot. I didn't really get into, like, major spoilers, so I think you're good if you haven't watched it. But if you're very, like, anal about not having anything explained to you before you watch a movie, then maybe don't watch this. The beginning had a really good, strong start with the Amazonian sequence. I loved it. Basically, the Amazonian Olympics. And then, I mean, that kind of set up a certain tone, and I really loved it, and that reminded me of the first movie. And I loved that. But, that tone didn't really continue throughout the film, and so it felt a little bit scattered in regards to the tone, but I'll get a little bit more into that in a second. But going from the mascara, we go into, like, cheesy 80s vibes, and I personally loved that, like, the whole kind of, the intro after the Amazonian Olympics was pretty cool and a little bit reminiscent of the old Wonder Woman show, just a little bit, you know, touching on that. I mean, this movie was very 80s. It wanted you to know it was very 80s, which, you know, some people love, some people hate it. There are a lot of people in between. We'll get to where I'm at in a second. I remember a while back, I saw in an interview, Patty Jenkins, the director, she spoke specifically about why she made this movie take place in the 80s. I mean, there's so many decades to do, and it seems like such a stark contrast from the previous film. And I really enjoyed her answer. She basically, you know, says that, you know, the first movie is beautiful. It's like it's a war film, essentially. And it's set in a time where there's a lot of scarcity, and it's dark, and it's gritty, it's dirty, and it's rough. It's just a completely different time, right? And so she wanted to make, like, a 180, a completely different movie from that movie. So she figured, you know, what's the complete opposite of that? And it's the 80s. It's a time of just excess, more, and consumerism, and it's like, you know, booming economy and all of that. So she really wanted to have the juxtaposition within those two films, and I personally think that's awesome. It's fun, it's creative, and the 80s is one of my favorite eras. So she was able to have fun with all the bright colors. Sorry if you hear that, that's my mini fridge. So it's basically just over the top and really campy, and it's absolutely that. And I like the switch up where, in the first film, you know, Gal's character of Diana, she's basically like a fish out of water. She's entering this world that she's never seen before, and she's so amazed by everything she sees, and she kind of has Steve to guide her through all that. Whereas in this film, the roles are reversed for a little bit, you know, where Chris is like, Chris, Steve, you know, he's been thrown into this completely different decade where he has no idea, you know, all the different advancements in technology. So it's a fun little sequence that it goes on for a little bit, but it doesn't go on for too long. Gal Gadot is so shit on Twitter. Like, people shit on her for her acting skills. And, of course, I don't think she's the best actress in the world. I think that she has a lot of talent, and she has a lot of potential given the right roles. too. Like, she's very big, like a large persona, like physically, you know, she's very tall and she just kind of commands a space. And I think that that's very necessary for Wonder Woman. I think she did that really well. Chris Pine was fantastic. Just as wonderful as in the previous film. It was nice to see him again. Kristen Wiig as Cheetah. I really wish there was just more Cheetah, period, because the character of Cheetah is amazing. And Kristen Wiig as Cheetah, I absolutely adored it. I fell in love. I feel like she absolutely nailed it. And I really wish there was more written for her, because I think she would have just blown it out of the water. And I've seen Kristen in more serious roles before. There's a particular movie that I really like. What is it called? Teenage. Did I write it down? I don't know if it's called The Diary of a Teenage. Oh my god, I can't remember what it's called. Also, she's in Skeleton Twins with Bill Hader. Anyways, she's done really amazingly in serious roles, so I had no doubt that she was going to be able to take on the character. But I was really excited to see that. I personally loved the transition that Barbara had from, you know, little old Barbara into an actual villain. Sometimes you feel like they're so, like, overdone, and DC in particular has really done those transitions perfectly. They do them all the time. It's like their formula that they have for like a wine or for like a meager woman into like a badass villain. We see it with Michelle Pfeiffer with Catwoman. We saw her going from like all little Selena, who's like nervous, and then she becomes Catwoman. And of course we see it with Dr. Harley Quinzel turning into Harley. Poison Ivy, Pamela Isley, we saw it with Uma Thurman. Like, she was just like a mild-mannered doctor, soft-spoken, and then bam, you know? So I feel like DC does this very often. It's that trope of, like, mild-mannered and weak female, you know, going through this transformation and becoming, like, a badass, strong female villain. And I don't know. It just works, in my opinion. It works, and I just love watching that unfold on screen. So I do hope that we see more of Kristen as Cheetah, because I really want to see more Cheetah versus Wonder Woman. I think that we need to see more of that. Pedro Pascal, my love. If you follow me on social media, or just if you know me in person, I love me some Pedro. I'm not going to get into it, because I could go on and on, but he was a very interesting addition to the film, and his character was really the one that was most strongly linked to the overall plot of the movie. So he's basically the epitome of this theme of wanting more, of like excess and just more, more, more. And he's known as the oil guy, which is so, like, he comes across as a like seedy, sleazy, con man type of character. Very like smooth with the gold, like, you know, with the jewelry and the suits, you know, the kind that I'm talking about. He's just portraying that over the top TV personality of Maxwell Lord. So what I do like and appreciate about Max is that there are a lot of layers to him. You know, there, the addition of his son brings, you know, there's a level of compassion, so we kind of empathize a bit with that, you know, seeing that there's something that anchors him down to humanity, and to his morals and ethics, and when you have something like that anchoring down your villain, you can almost always assume that there's going to be some sort of a redemption, or you just kind of are holding on to hope of redemption for them. Or sometimes you're not, sometimes you just want a cool villain. That's cool too. And that's kind of with his son, we can sympathize with him, and we understand it, that his whole wanting more stems from him wanting to be able to provide for his son, and for his son to be proud of him. So that's kind of a theme that goes on. He really just wants people to respect him and his son to be proud of him. He's a very troubled and messy character, and it's just extremely fun to watch Pedro take that character on. I'm a little biased because I love Pedro, and I feel like he can do no wrong. The character itself was because of Pedro. But if it was anybody else playing him, I might not have felt the same. So take my opinion with a grain of salt. He's just such an amazing actor, and I feel like he draws you into anything that he plays because he's so engaging, and I definitely think he steals the show in a couple of scenes, so I will say that. So overall, I have to be honest, and I always have, like, two reviews for any sort of movie. I have my, like, critical review, and then I have my excited fangirl consumer review. So, as a fan of movies and entertainment, in DC in particular, and Wonder Woman in particular, I honestly just adored this movie. I really did. I can't say that this movie is without fault, because I'll get into that in a moment. But this movie, I don't know if you feel like you would like things that I like. It's just a fun movie. Like, it's a campy movie. It's a good-ass time. I really don't know what else to say. Like, that's my personal opinion. I truly enjoyed watching it. It's like, it's a loud 80s comic book movie. And the overall message is basically a good one. That truth is good, and truth is the way to go, and that you can't cheat and lie to get, you know, to take a shortcut to get to where you want to go. The message is always that great things can be deceiving, and to just think of the overall good as opposed to your own selfish wishes and desires. It's a pretty good message to just give out overall. Now, a couple of the issues I had. The plot itself was okay. It was not my favorite. I personally would not have gone with this plot. Personally, like, if I were to direct a Wonder Woman movie, or to write a movie, I wouldn't have gone with this plot. I feel like it needed a lot. It couldn't really stand on its own. I don't really know how to just explain how I feel about that. But that's just kind of how I feel. It wasn't the strongest plot. I feel like, you know, if you have a really good plot, you can execute it a little bit more easily. And if you have a weaker plot, you kind of have to find a bunch of things to weave into it in order for it to work. And I think that's kind of the issue that this movie had. The execution of the film. I feel that the movie wanted to do a lot of different things, and it tried to fit a lot of different sequences in, and I wanted to interweave different stories into it, and it just didn't flow as smoothly as it could have. I mentioned earlier the tone, and to me it kind of felt like the tone switches up in a couple of scenes. More specifically, like what I mentioned with the introduction and the mascara, and the rest of the movie. Just two different tones completely. And that's definitely due to, like, the time and the setting, which is understandable. But I think that's a personal preference, and I just wish that we would have seen more Amazonians in the movie, but that's just because I love seeing the badass Amazonian warriors. I will say, I do not think it's better than the first Wonder Woman. For me, Wonder Woman is still better than Wonder Woman 1984. But like I said, if you just are a fan and you're not too critical, and you can enjoy a movie without being super pessimistic about it, because I know there's some people that are like, oh, this is trash. I don't it's just good.